Spotlight, where we explore visionary founders shaping our future. I'm your host for today, Sabina, and today we will be diving into the question on what is the future and impact of multimodal AI and large language models. Now, today with me, I have three amazing founders who will help us understand a bit more and dive deeper. We have Elena from Ape AI, we have Adrian from Loop, and Mahmoud from Division X. Thank you guys for joining me today, and let's start with some brief introductions.
I'm Elena. I'm co-founder and CEO of Ape AI, and we are on a mission to make development of AI-powered products truly iterative and accessible to all. I'm not a coder. I have MBA and management consulting experience. So when I wanted to build AI app, I soon realized that it needed much more than no-code tools had to offer. So together with my co-founder and CTO, who's an ex-Amazon engineer, we created Ape AI. It is a platform that allows even someone like me to build AI-powered product and ship features fast and easily. It does it by handling complexities end-to-end and providing AI models and backend services for many functionalities. All of that with drag and drop and scalable cloud-native architecture, so full products become possible even for someone who's non-tech.
Really interesting. Thanks for having me here, Sabina. I'm Adrian, co-founder and CEO of Loop, and as Elena, I'm no technical founder, but I've been working for startups for the past 10 years or so, leading growth teams, expansion teams, and obviously getting really involved into the tech space, right? Like a couple of years ago, we started giving consultants about growth, management, OKR systems, and experimentation, but then we were thinking like, I mean, the AI is huge and we can try to impact more businesses, more people, and then we try to build Loop, which is a platform that integrates OKRs and AI enhanced experimentation to help companies achieve revenue faster, go to market entrance, and grow. Really, that's what we want to do with AI, and what we really think is that it should be a partnership between humans and AI, and that's what we're trying to build with Loop.
Nice. So what was?
Okay, thanks, Samina. So I'm Mahmoud from Division X. We at Division X simplifying the AI computer vision development through BOLDEST AI that is a one-stop platform to enable you to label your images, train and deploy your models, whatever it is in cloud or on edge. By Tuba, we enable as a domain expert to build your AI computer vision application in a seamless way without writing any line of code.
Thank you very much for your introductions. Again, very exciting. I see some common touch points as well as some differences that I would like to explore in this episode. So the topic of the podcast, of course, is that artificial intelligence technologies are evolving very rapidly with multimodal AI and large language models at the forefront of that innovation. Now, definitely not for me, because I definitely know exactly what that is, but for our listeners, can you summarize in very simple terms multimodal AI and large language models?
Yes, I'm happy to do so. So as for multimodal AI, it has to do with modalities. So there are different modalities, or you could say types of data. There is text, audio, image. So multimodal AI is just a model, one model that is capable of processing a variety of these types. For example, it receives image and it generates text. And for large language models, these are the models that have been trained on large data sets, and they are capable of processing natural language and trained for a wide range of tasks. So for example, generating text.
Oh, thank you. I think that was a very clear explanation. And with that now, let's jump into the main question, which is, where do you see these technologies evolving within 10 years? And even maybe more interesting for me, how do you see your companies contributing to that growth?
I mean, I could go. I believe there's a huge impact for the next couple 10 years. I would say let's just go to healthcare or education. You could, with the multimodal AI, imagine getting to analyze a lot of images, a lot of patient information to get like better insights to improve people's lives. I mean, that's something super powerful to me, but the same thing happens in education. And talking about education, that's where I want to connect it with Loop. Like what we're trying to do is, out of the OKRs and the experimentation comes first with understanding what the methodology is. So for me, it's like getting those LLMs just to try to understand what people is thinking about the OKRs or how to experiment or how to run effective experiments and how to grow their businesses. It's the input for us to try to, okay, this is how people try to achieve successful things in their businesses, how to grow, how to acquire customers, how to even improve retention, how to fundraise. I don't know, there's a lot of things there. And then for us, what we're trying to do is to try to gather that data and try to put it into better insights and better recommendations for them, so the acceleration goes faster, and at the end it's a global impact, not only for the companies but the countries that the people is living in. So I believe it's what we're trying to do right now.
Nice.
And from my side, I think from as I'm coming from manufacturing sector, so we have a lot of separate models happening together. So by multimodal systems and the LLMs, so we are combining all systems together in one. So now we are able to combine the image, anything with images, with data coming from sensors, with data coming from the domain expert too, all of them in one system. So we can integrate all systems together in one, and the user can chat with it and they can generate information from it directly.
Very clear. But I think it is clear for me with Elena and Adrian, and for you, who would be your ideal users? Because my next question will be very much related to how you work with your customers.
Yes, from our side, our ideal users are from maybe manufacturing sector, system integrators, software companies who want to build AI computer vision softwares based on their own data.
I will jump into that question in a minute, but Elena, what about your answer to our deep dive main topic?
Yes, so when it comes to multimodal AI and LLMs, it's definitely very innovative technology. And as Adrian and Mahmoud mentioned, there are so many use cases already, and adoption rates in industries like healthcare and pharmaceutical, or maybe functions like marketing, sales, is increasing, and that trend will continue. But I think what's most exciting is that we don't know what we don't know, and there could be so many use cases out there that haven't been discovered yet, just because experts in traditionally non-technical fields don't have those capabilities yet. It's already very easy to use AI, but it's still very difficult to build AI products. And I think that's where we as AI contribute most, because we bring this capability to experts without technical skills. And I think it will contribute to discovering more use cases.
Very nice. Again, I see a lot of common touch points. So I do want to kind of see what is it that you want your customers, your ideal customers, to know? So something to be aware of, or something that you wish they did.
I believe from my perspective is that, again, I believe between AI and the human part, it's more like a partnership. I mean, we're providing like a help, right? And I believe AI is going to become, it's already being, but it's going to become even a more powerful tool to predict big amounts of data and text and images and whatever you want. But I believe the human side is super important about the emotional intelligence, about the strategic thinking, about, and for me, for my business, it's, since it's about setting the right goals and creating the right experiments, it's like, probably, I mean, I don't know, I cannot guess for the future, but I'd say it's still gonna be super needed, that emotional and human touch when it comes to making businesses. Like, I don't know, it's about your gut, but it's gonna be easier if you have, like, yeah, a lot of data already in an insightful way with some trends that are going to help you. Okay, this is the best way to do it, and this is the way I'm gonna help my company growth. So that's what I would say is the most important thing. It's a partnership.
Nice. What do you think, guys?
I think from my side, from the business side, to the stakeholders or the managing directors, to know how they can build a data-driven organizations. And from this concept, they can build a lot of things and build a lot of values through this business. And also from the tech side, if they have their data ready or not, as we have many challenges in making the data is ready or not, or need to be collected, is it structured or not. So we have a lot of hassles here with many customers. So they need to look at their data and see what they can do from it here.
Very clear.
And from my side, I would like to say that since we target like non-tech domain experts or incomplete teams that don't have all the skills in place, I would like them to know that it could be possible to build much more than they can imagine, and it is possible for them to be part of this innovation and to contribute to the use cases that they have so much expertise to bring because they know those industries, and they should go for it and try to innovate and create some solutions.
I'm already on the wait list for API. I'm gonna be a powerful user.
Yeah, as Adrian is an expert in OKRs, so this is kind of target customers.
Oh yeah, by the way, that's also a good bridge to maybe my next question, because how do you then envision solutions like yours collaborating to help achieve that impact within AI, multimodal AI, large language models, any applications of these innovative technologies?
Like I was just saying, I was in a meeting yesterday with Olena, and she was telling me like she was getting me a really good onboarding process with her tool, and I was like, man, I really need this. I really need this in my life because I'm no technical founder, and I was telling sometimes I get so frustrated because I want to move so fast in order to do and build my product. And it's not sometimes the best way to do it because I have not the capabilities to write code and do that. But what they're doing, I was like, once you release it, please let me be one of the first customers. So that's one way to do it. And then also, I believe at some point when Mahmoud and Lena's businesses are growing, that I know they will probably, then they can integrate a really cool OKR and experimentation platform as well.
Yes, definitely.
Oh, I love this vision. But I love we're talking a lot about the vision, the positive impact, but do you see any challenges on our way to actually reach that? Challenges on our particular way, but then also challenges on the global level? And how would you even approach them?
So I would like to say that when it comes to this type of technologies, as they are very new, there are always risks and challenges. So one that comes to mind is inaccuracy, risk of inaccuracy. Of course, we want the output of these technologies to be the most contributing and adding value, so we want to avoid it. And I think the best way to approach it is to use as much as possible fine-tuning, prompt engineering, and also like applying context on the model so it responds and reacts the way you want it. And on our solution, we also enable that so that the users can take standard foundation model, but also apply their own expertise and context on it.
Okay, I think I add something also from challenges that the organization readiness to apply AI, and also their awareness for this apply. So the problem that all companies and organizations right now need to apply AI. Yes, we need AI, but okay, are you ready or not? Which sector or which part you need to apply it first as a priority or a business value, maybe don't know. So the problem is here. So more awareness and also readiness for applying AI.
But what does it mean to be ready?
If I'm talking about businesses, maybe also manufacturing or robotics, their data is ready or not. There's a term we called OT-IT connection. So if their data is already up in the IT level or not, if they're already installed all the hardware required or not. So there's a lot of stuff that's happening on the floor before going to applying in any level of advanced AI systems.
Very good.
Clear. Do you have any other points that companies should have, or even people, individuals should have before they apply AI, before they enter this?
Yeah, I definitely agree with what Mahmoud said about value. They need to be clear on kind of vision value they're trying to create, have some sort of guiding star for the project. And if they do have challenges with yet technological readiness, especially in terms of have outdated tech stack, I would say it's definitely a challenge, but there could be some ways around it, especially finding solutions which are more like end-to-end and allow you to build product without really relying on your existing tech stack as much as possible, and try experimenting while you have some time to improve your technology in-house.
I agree with you. I mean,
and timeline wise, so I know that I said, okay, what do you see happening within 10 years? But actually, when do you think we will have this next major milestone? Because I think, of course, we all know artificial intelligence technologies have been out there for a while. But I would say with the implementation of all of these ChatGPT and other tools, that's where it went out to the mass market, so to say. When do you see the next big milestone happening and everyone knowing what multimodal and large language models mean, actually?
Well, that's I believe it's a tough question because I believe it's happening right now. I mean, it's been growing so fast. I believe faster than we all expected, that it could be probably tomorrow or it could be probably in a year. So I don't know. I believe the most important thing is that when it happens, hopefully it will happen in the better way for the humanity as well. I mean, in terms of adaptability and trust, because there's a lot of misunderstanding about these topics and many people are struggling to understand what's happening and how to use this for their day-to-day lives and in their personal and work lives. So I believe the change is coming like really fast at us. I couldn't be able to say you like a time frame. It's going to be in 2 or 3 years because it probably could be tomorrow. Actually, you never know. But hopefully, it goes the right way. I believe it's going the right way.
What do you think?
I think what's happening now is we call it human augmented AI. So we mean the human to learn the AI models how they can behave with data and learn from it. But I think the next milestone will be self-learning AI. And I think it's coming soon. Soon, maybe within 2 years, 5 years, something like that.
Yeah, from my side, I think for me, what would define the next milestone is kind of two things. One is the adoption, and in a way that adoption by those companies that don't necessarily have all the skills in place and they have expertise in some non-tech industry. So when I see that massively happening, I think that will define a milestone for me on the one hand. On the other hand, as it goes for challenges, as we discussed, one of the challenges is how computationally intensive these models are. So there is a lot of R&D happening. And I think if it happens that they become less intensive on computational power, that will be also definition of the key milestone.
Nice. And actually, of course, because now you're startups, well, very fastly accelerating startups, but how do you see collaboration between startups, large companies, customers, let it be smaller companies or individuals? How do you see that collaboration working towards achieving this impact together?
I believe one of the big advantages of being a startup is that you can communicate really fast. Then, therefore, you can educate really fast the user. So I think that's a good approach that we, since we're accessing a market in a faster way, probably we're going to be helping the big corporations and enterprises and institutions to get that sense of what's important about the AI and how can it be really truly impactful to the world.
Yeah, and from my side, I think there is definitely a lot of collaboration needed, especially to strengthen the ecosystem. And I think that a lot of players have unique position to contribute. For example, large tech companies, I believe they will continue innovating and doing R&D on the large scale, especially creating foundation models. Then startups or smaller innovative teams, even in big corporations, will continue pushing the boundaries of the innovation very focused way, like discovering use cases and building solutions for those, or fine-tuning those models towards their unique specific use cases. And I think this is actually creating the ecosystem where some of the players could act as platforms for components, others, and also including tools like ours, could act as platforms for assembling those components into full products, and startups teams could act also as those that bring it to the end users and actually add most value.
Yeah, I like that vision.
Yeah, I think I agree with Alina also that startups can make something fast innovative out of the box with focusing on solving a specific challenge with corporate. From the corporate side, maybe they have their innovation team or something like that, so they can see what's happening inside the corporate and what's the challenges that they face, and then a startup can go and solve it, and then they can spread it in the whole ecosystem of the corporate.
Well, I do love this vision, and let's manifest it for the world globally. Now, we have discussed a lot today, and keeping in mind kind of that our listeners are investors, mentors, other founders, and corporate innovators from, again, all over the world, what is one thing that you want them to take out of this episode, one thing that you want them to remember?
I think I would say one thing is that we all need to collaborate, and that everyone has something to contribute, whether it is expertise in the industry, or it is some sort of tool, or it is some sort of component. And I think the innovation will happen when we all come together and build together.
I agree totally with that. And just to compliment, I would say it's about creating an ecosystem, right? It's like we need corporations, corporations need startups. People are going to work either in corporations and startups, but then we can help contribute to the world and to make a really big impact in different ways. So I would say it's about creating an ecosystem with the different actors in it to make this like the best way of it.
Okay, I think all the things about enabling. So we enable others to make something, and you enable us to make something. So all of us enable ourselves to solve our problems and our challenges.
Now, thank you very much, Olena, Adrian, Mahmoud, for being here with me today. And thank you very much for explaining to me and our listeners and helping us envision the future of AI, and in this particular case, the future of multimodal AI and large language models. And thank you, dear listeners. I hope that you enjoyed this episode. And if you are enjoying this, then you probably need to be in Startup Bootcamp ecosystem if you are not already. Whether it is that you want to invest in a startup, support a startup as a mentor, or you are a founder yourself, please join. Go to startupbootcamp.org, check out the upcoming events, the open accelerators where we still accept the applications to be a part of these programs. Follow us on social media. There is always something where you can participate. Thank you very much. And remember, innovation will save the world.